When you need a collection of something in Swift, you instinctively reach for an array, don't you? Stop it. Stop and think, would a set work here? Because if it does, you get some serious benefits, like much better performance and some really powerful methods to help you compare different sets. Today, you're going to learn the differences between sets and arrays and when you should use each, which is a very common interview question, by the way, as well as some superpowers of sets that you probably didn't know about. Today's video is sponsored by Squarespace. Let's compare sets versus arrays. Both are collections, but here are the key differences. An array can have duplicate items in it. For example, if you had a list of first names in a class, you could have the same first name more than once. An array is always in the same order. That example of students in a class again, this array you see here, that order is not going to change, unless you do something to change it, of course. Every time you access this student's array, that order is going to be the same. That's why arrays are less performant than sets, is because it keeps that order. Anytime you want to look up an item in the array or do any manipulation on the array, it has to check every item in that array, so the time complexity is O of n, which basically means as the array grows larger and larger and larger, the longer it will take to do these lookups or mutations. The key differences for a set are that it can have no duplicates. So like that student's example where we had multiple first names, well, a set, nope, you can only have one of each item. Sets are also unordered. So anytime I access this student set, that order is not guaranteed. I'm gonna get a different order every time probably. Now you may be thinking, well, having duplicates and having everything always be in the same order, those are really desirable attributes of an array. But again, remember the trade-off. That makes arrays less performant. Whereas a set, when it's unordered, everything is unique, and everything in a set has to conform to hashable. And this allows for constant time lookup. So remember the array, if you wanted to look something up or map over the array, the time that takes will be proportionate to how large the array is. Whereas a set, whether the set has 10 items in it or 10,000 items in it, that lookup time will be the same. It will be constant time. So if you're dealing with small data, you know, there's only 10 to 20 items in an array, it's probably irrelevant. But if you start dealing with really large arrays, this is something you must know. These are the key differences you need to know between a set and array. But sets also have some really cool methods I'm going to show you. So not only do you get better performance with a set, you get these really powerful methods that help you compare and pull out data from various sets. Let me show you some examples in code. Here in my playground, I have four different sets, as you can see. I have one called SwiftUI devs, Swift devs, Kotlin devs, and Experience devs. And you can see some of the names overlap. So imagine we have lists of various developers that have these qualifications, and we want to compare these sets to pull out, you know, common items or make sure one group is not in another group. Now, of course, these examples are real simple. There's only 2 to 5 names in it. But as I'm doing these examples, imagine you had a set with 1,000 names in it. First up, let's see where two sets overlap. For example, I wanna see Experience devs and SwiftUI devs. Now you can probably tell just by looking at it right now that Sean is the only one that overlaps, but let me show you the code to pull that out. Again, imagine you had a list of 1,000 names. You know, you wouldn't be able to just look at it. So we wanna say, let Experienced SwiftUI devs equal SwiftUI devs. That's this set here on line 3. We can say dot intersection of, and you see you pass in another set, experienced devs. So what this is going to do is it's going to see where the overlap is between an experienced devs and Swift UI devs, and it's going to put it out into its own set here. So if I run this, you can see over on the right, the only one that's going to be in there is Sean, because that is the only one that is in Swift UI devs and experienced devs. So like I said, if you had a list of 1,000 names and you wanted to see which names are on both lists, simple little one-liner to pull out all those names. Again, this is the power of sets, and I have a bunch more examples to show you of the cool stuff you can do. Next up is kind of the opposite of intersect, is subtract. So let's say I wanted a Swift developer that wasn't experienced. Maybe I wanted a junior developer specifically. So that's what I want to check for. They want to be in the Swift dev set, but not in the experienced dev set. So that's what we're going to check out. So we can say let junior Swift dev equal Swift devs dot subtracting experienced devs. So now when I run it, you'll see the only name, I believe it's just James. I believe James is my only junior developer here. Yep, there it is, James. So if you look at the experienced devs, you got Sean, Ava, Olivia, Leo, Maya, and you see Olivia, Maya, Leo, they're all in there, Sean's in there. The only one that's not an experienced dev is James. So you can see you can subtract the differences between two very large lists. And just to show you that, let me take out Maya from the experienced devs real quick and run it again. And then now you'll see James and Maya because Maya is no longer in the experienced devs. Another cool one here is disjoint. So we can check to see if there's any overlap between two sets. And this returns a Boolean. So I'll say Swift UI devs dot is disjoint with Kotlin devs. If there's not an overlap, it will return true. If there is an overlap, it will return false. You can see the SwiftUI devs are Sean and James, and the Kotlin devs, Olivia, Elijah, Leo, Maya, Dan, there's no overlap, so that returns true. Now, if I change Kotlin devs to Swift devs, there is gonna be an overlap, so is disjoint returns false. So again, if you had a huge list and you wanna make sure there's no overlap between the lists, there you go, disjoint is for you. Now, union is a way to combine two sets. So for example, SwiftUI devs and Swift devs, that's fairly similar. Let's just combine that into one list. But you know, in a set, you can only have one name. So if I were combining two arrays, I would end up with two Sean's and two James in this combined array. But because I want uniqueness in this set, when I do this union, it will compare these two sets and combine them, but it will actually turn into the Swift devs array because, you know, Sean and James are already in there, but that's what it will do. It will do Swift UI devs.union with Swift devs. And if I go down here and run it, you will see over here, Sean, James, Olivia, Maya, Leo. And again, that is the Sean, James, Olivia, Maya, Leo, because we just combined these two, we unioned them. Now let's say we want to compare the two lists of names and we want to see who only belongs to one list, right? Let's take Swift devs and Kotlin devs. Say we don't want someone who's like cross-platform developer, kind of knows a little bit of both. We want specialist. We want someone who only focuses on Swift dev or only focuses on Kotlin dev. So again, we can see if they're exclusive only to one of them. So I can say Swift devs dot, it's a symmetrical difference of Kotlin devs. Now here, this will give me, whoops, I gotta call this something, let specialists, right? This will spit out another set here. So run that and you'll see who are the specialists? Elijah, Sean, James, and Dan. And you can compare the Swift devs and the Kotlin devs and you can see Elijah's only a Kotlin dev, Sean is only a Swift dev. So you can see they're the unique ones to the two lists. So like I keep saying, if you had two super large lists of names and you wanted to do all these comparisons, sets are just a lifesaver. These little one-liners spit out so much good stuff. And I saved the simple ones for last. So subset, if you know what the word subset means, pretty self-explanatory. So it returns a Boolean. So you can say Swift UI devs dot is subset of Swift devs. This is gonna return true, right? Because you can see Sean and James in Swift devs are in Swift UI devs. So Swift UI devs is a subset. But this is a quick, again, little one-liner check. If you wanna see if something is a subset, that should return true. And then let's change Swift devs to Kotlin devs. And then that should return false because SwiftUI devs is not a subset of that. Superset is basically the reverse. So you do Swift devs.is superset. So that means if it's a superset of the subset of SwiftUI devs, this should return true. Again, because SwiftUI devs being the superset contains SwiftUI devs. Run it just to check. True. Again, so subset, superset checks, pretty simple. And then insert, delete, and find. Say Swift devs.insert new member, we'll say Joe goes into Swift devs. Now remember, the order doesn't matter. On an array, you append it to the end. You're just inserting it here and then the order gets jumbled up. But there you go, you can insert Joe, or I can do Swift devs.remove, let's remove Sean, and I can do Swift devs.contains Maya. And then here I will print Swift devs down here. So now when I run this, you can see I've inserted Joe, I've removed Sean. So Swift devs does contain Maya is true. And now the new Swift devs set that has added Joe and removed Sean. There you go. There's Joe and there's no more Sean. So again, insert, remove, contains. Those are the constant times, super performant things on a set. Again, if you have a super large data set. Squarespace is an all-in-one platform to help you get that iOS developer portfolio, blog, or personal website up and running very quickly. Now I know we're all developers with the skills and the desire to build the web page ourselves. But I would argue there's an opportunity cost to your time. If you're an iOS developer trying to build a great product, a great app, maybe spending a lot of time learning the ins and outs of web development, responsive design, isn't the best way to spend your time. That's why I recommend Squarespace to build that personal website, the blog, your portfolio, or maybe a landing page for your app. They have all kinds of beautiful themes and templates to get you started. They handle all the analytics and the SEO for you. Again, it just saves you so much time so you can get back to doing what you want to do, and that is building iOS apps. So when you're ready to get started, go to squarespace.com to start your free trial. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/SeanAllen to get 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain.